In an interview with The Telegraph, published by Tristram Fain Saunders on February 8, 2023, there was an interesting paragraph. For months, Waters has been secretly working on a new version of Pink Floyd's psychedelic journey through life and death, sanity and madness, The Dark Side of the Moon. He has re-recorded it from scratch, without the involvement or even knowledge of any of his old bandmates. He's still polishing the final details, but plays me a full-length cut. At the time of writing, I'm one of just a handful of people to have heard it from start to finish. What I hear comes as a genuine surprise. It turns out to be a curate's egg. Parts are very good indeed. Time, that young man's lament for mortality, sounds terrific with his old man's timbre. Breathe is wonderfully reimagined as a slow acoustic groove. A country-tinged Money could be a late Johnny Cash cut, with Waters growling charismatically at the very bottom of his register. But surprisingly, Waters seems to have decided that what was wrong with the original album's beautiful instrumental tracks was that they didn't have Waters talking all over them. Now they do. However intriguing this project may have been, more was said about the drama. In that same interview, he said, "They can't write. Well, Nick never pretended, but Gilmore and Rick, they can't write songs, they've nothing to say. They are not artists. They have no ideas, not a single one between them. They never have had, and that drives them crazy. It's not as vacuous as Drake, but it's pretty vacuous." He would then state, "I wrote The Dark Side of the Moon, let's get rid of all this wee crap. Of course, we were a band, there were four of us, we all contributed, but it's my project and I wrote it, so blah." The reaction to this was intense, as you could guess, though it was ultimately only a part of a long string of attacks going back to the 70s. It's a feud that would only intensify as Polly Sampson, writer and wife of David Gilmour, would make a fairly infamous tweet accusing Waters of everything from anti-Semitism to tax evasion, a tweet which was then co-signed by Gilmour. The entire thing was certainly not helped by Waters' own deeply controversial statements and numerous attempts to show the man's dark side. There were so many controversies that I genuinely cannot put them all here, but the thing to note was that at the eye of the hurricane was The Dark Side of the Moon re-recording. From the moment it was announced, it was fucked.
You know, when Roger says in the middle of the track, "Welcome to hell," he means it in more ways than one. Maybe inadvertently, but definitely more ways than one.
But this album, as it stands, for me, it's good for one listen, and then you go, If you're one of those people who say, "Oh, it's great," that's fine, but I don't believe you. I don't believe you that you're going to, you know, listen to this as much as you listen to the original. I'm sorry, that's a lie.
It was like staring at a blank wall and trying to find something good in it. It was just, and I really, really tried.
If Waters felt the need to show how non-essential his bandmates were to the album, he should have done so completely on his own and let his words and voice speak for themselves. But the fact that he substitutes his words and voice for their instrumental contributions and then backs it all up with a surrogate band shows both a lack of bravery and lack of musical talent.
Have you ever seen anything like this? I swear to God, I've... 16. A bunch of people who I trust gave this shit straight zero.
On one hand, I really shouldn't be surprised. In fact, I expected it. Anything Waters does today is going to be met with disapproval, and this was no different. What I didn't expect was for it to be so infamous. The idea essentially became a joke in music circles, and the reviews only hammered that home. The general takeaway from the album was that it was trying to fix something that wasn't broken, or more cynically, that it was an attempt to erase Pink Floyd and to make it seem that Waters was the sole reason the album turned out the way it did. The project was, to the eyes of its critics, the pure culmination of ego and a sacrilegious attempt to rewrite history using the band's magnum opus. It was personal. Now, as you may know, I'm a major Pink Floyd fan. I own most of the records, only barring the archival releases as of late, though I have heard them. I've seen the remaining members as many times as I could. I own books and DVDs and autographs and posters and literal contract documents from the band. I went all the way to Los Angeles to see a single Pink Floyd exhibit. That's the type of dedicated I am. Yet every Floyd fan seems to have some sort of preference, and while I love every era of the band, I seem to head towards the Waters camp more. So when this all happened, I had a lot of opinions both on the drama of it all and the actual material, and I listened to the album as soon as it dropped. I read Rate Your Music reviews right as it finished, and I have to say something. My bias is already stated, so take it with a grain of salt. But there was nothing here on the album that I found remotely close to offensive. I didn't even think it was a boring album. That's not to say it was perfect or anything, but it was good. It was pretty close to what I imagined it would be based on his previous work and the already existing singles. It is a competent, risky endeavor. So when I read reviews that think this is a worst of the year contender, I have to scratch my head in confusion. I think DSOTM Redux is an album that will be largely misunderstood, both because of things about it and things around it. It's an album that is being dismissed at face value. And I think that's a shame because there's a lot on DSOTM Redux that I do find to be genuinely interesting. That's both within the actual text of the album and from a more meta perspective. I think there's a lot to say about DSOTM Redux, both good and bad, and I want to rationalize why it exists in the way it does because, well, nobody else will. We have to start with the central question, why? This is the question that fundamentally shifts how you view this album. Not the music or the production, the reasoning. The general arguments I've seen are based mostly on Waters' character. Waters has a history of ego-driven musical pursuits, legal battles, and headline-gaining controversies. Perhaps this is no different. Waters sees himself as the writer of The Dark Side of the Moon, and therefore the Redux is a way to put himself front and center. The band Pink Floyd is no longer a part, it's merely a Roger Waters creation. I mean, he said so himself, right? Therefore, he is rewriting history to make himself the only person that matters. On a much less accusatory level is this line of reasoning, that the Redux is a way to try and fix perceived wrongs with the original record, not realizing that it was never broken to begin with. Either driven by ego or a genuine misunderstanding, Waters is using the record to right some wrongs that he had with the original. This begs the question why he didn't go for the final cut or Umagumma or whatever. I want to play devil's advocate here because when you look at the arguments and then take a step back to view his career as a whole, the less it makes sense. First, Waters loves the original album and doesn't think there's anything necessarily wrong with it.
This record actually deserves a reimagining. We could do a redux of this simply because the message has stood the test of time, the concept has stood the test of time, and it's a really important thing. It needed to be re-expressed, and it seemed like a really good way to celebrate the 50 years that the original recorded version of this work has survived.
He also said,
I love the original recording, by the way, and I love what Nicky did and what Rick did and what Dave did on the original recording.
Later, he would even celebrate Richard Wright for his work in collaboration on Us and Them, as well as vocally defend Gilmore after an article misquoted his opinion. The one thing Waters had in mind when coming back to it was the concept.
The new recording is more reflective, I think, and it's more indicative of what the concept of the record was. It is a reinterpretation, and I hope that we can gain more from it than we did back in 1973 when it first came out, because it's been part of all of our lives for 50 years, and yet we are still not yet breathing in the air.
Waters' issue, if we want to call it that, with the original is that people aren't largely taking its message. When they sing about the us versus them dynamics of war and class, he feels that the message isn't reaching people. To play under the argument that he's fixing the album, if he thinks he wrote the album, then this is his failure. It's not an issue with Gilmore or Wright or Mason, it's with him. He's going back to reiterate the point. I also don't think he has an issue with the album because he's played it straight for decades. He toured it in the 2000s, he featured the material prominently on Us Plus Them, and he even played the entire second side of the album as part of This Is Not a Drill. And to make it clear, he's still doing that. He's currently touring This Is Not a Drill in South America, and it's very close to the original. If it was truly a way to correct perceived wrongs of the original record and to make a new definitive version, at least in his mind, it sure did take a while. He sure loved putting it into all of the shows exactly as it was on the album for a guy who apparently felt it needed fixing. The idea that this was a way to replace the band or a way to correct an issue seems wrong to me, or at least misguided, especially considering that this wasn't even the first time he did something like this. Last year, he released The Lockdown Sessions, an album of reworked Pink Floyd and solo material done during the COVID-19 pandemic. These versions are wildly different, though not far from what DSOTM Redux does. In fact, it was controversial in its own right for the same perceived reasons, especially with the release of his version of Comfortably Numb, which featured no guitar solos. Going back to the beginning of the 2010s was his version of The Wall, which is The Wall, but it is very unique. There's a new song, the message is different, the aesthetic choices are much more gritty. Even all the way back in the 80s and 90s, he was adding things to songs that were never there. None of this is new, really. More obvious, sure, but Waters has always been messing around with his material. And at the end of the day, I don't even know if the band actually took offense. The only person who commented on the album was Nick Mason, who said it was absolutely brilliant and that it was an add-on to the original album. One of the things I like about any sort of existing piece of music is to develop it or find some extra quality in it. I just like the idea of developing music rather than trying to retain it exactly as it was. While Polly Sampson quoted the Berliner Zeitung article as the thing that prompted her infamous tweet, it's unclear if the Redux was even part of why it happened. In a time where all the gloves are off and any offense can be broadcasted to the world, it seems weird to me that they never really talked about it. But really, who knows how they actually feel. But you may be thinking that he said that Gilmore and Wright didn't have an idea between them. The issue is, I think even this statement deserves some questioning. Based on everything I've read, Waters views an artist not as a person who makes music, but a person who envisions that music. Waters is, for better and for worse, someone who works with concepts. He puts importance not necessarily on the music, though that is important, but on the actual meaning of the work. He'll admit that the band members did contribute because there is no world where they didn't contribute. But we're talking about ideas, writing, and to him, they didn't have those. Gilmore and Wright never really wrote in the way that Waters did. They didn't have those grand ideas. They're closer to composers than lyricists and, therefore, artists. To be clear, I don't agree with Waters on this issue. I think it's a really shallow view. However, that is the line of reasoning here. Waters is the artist, the visionary, the person who put modern life into words. The rest of Pink Floyd, however, are composers and musicians. When they write without meaning. Gilmore can write Learning to Fly, but he won't write Us and Them. This is all controversial, and like I said before, I don't even necessarily agree. But I don't think it's hard to understand what Waters is trying to say here. He wrote The Dark Side of the Moon. Pink Floyd made it and recorded it, but he's the one who put pen to paper. And if you believe that what constitutes an artist is vision, then it's him. So why was the Redux made? Earlier I mentioned that he felt that the message was being lost somewhere, and that was definitely a part. You also have to take into account the timing. March 1st of 2023 was the 50th anniversary of The Dark Side of the Moon. It was to celebrate the album by making a new version of it 50 years later, and one that would reflect on modern times. In fact, the Telegraph article mentions that the album was meant to be released in March. That's the mission statement clear as day, and he's been saying that since the beginning. The new concept is meant to reflect on the meaning of the work, to bring out the heart and soul of the album, musically and spiritually. The original Dark Side of the Moon feels in some ways like the lament of an elder being on the human condition, but Dave, Rick, Nick, and I were so young when we made it, and when you look at the world around us, clearly the message hasn't stuck. That's why I started to consider what the wisdom of an 80-year-old could bring to a reimagined version. We can theorize all day about what this album could and could not be, but it's a game that nobody wins. It's a waste of time. Waters' intent is explicitly stated, and at this point, that's all you can really say. With that central question out of the way, I think I can begin to say my own opinions on the actual piece. To put it bluntly, I think DSOTM Redux is a daring though imperfect companion to the original. It is, for better and for worse, a Roger Waters album. Its worst elements feel like oversights, but its best are interesting additions to an old concept. It never eclipses the original, but that was never the point. It's not the album we want, but it's the album we deserve. One of the biggest points of contention is the spoken word segments, and I can 100% see why, because I don't think it always lands, though more often than not I think it's fine. The album opens with a reading of the lyrics for the Obscured by Clouds track Free 4, and it's a great tone setter for the aged voice and worldview of Waters himself. It's cynical and frustrated, and quite honestly fitting for the year 2023. Money got a lot of shit for its poem, but I found it to be an interesting noir-esque take on capitalism. It's the sort of plot you'd see in an old black and white film, and with the song's lounge aesthetic, it fits pretty well. My personal favorite, however, is probably The Great Gig in the Sky, which centers on the passing of poet Donald Hall and Waters' communication with him in his final days. Waters adds a personal grief to the song, which is made more potent due to his voice. That said, On the Run would have been my favorite if it weren't for a glaring issue. I really like how frantic and paranoid it ends up being, with a noticeably different groove than the original. That said, I think its core concept is flimsy. The song is a description of a dream about a fight between good and evil. It starts anxiously with an inescapable, helpless situation compared to everyday inconveniences before ramping up into an accidental stabbing and then... that. The forces of evil are then depicted as a circus with jugglers and knife throwers. So far, the poem is an interesting take on the song's original paranoia, twisting it into a new story about morality. I think it's a genuinely great route for this album to go down, but then it just collapses. The forces are defeated to much celebration, but a new wave appears. Waters, now surrounded, is prepared to die, but is saved by the voice of reason.
Be gone, the fire, forward a bleak voice ordained.
Described as having a voice like Atticus Finch, the voice of reason dissipates the evil in the world and tears down the circus. When I say the voice of reason comes in to save the day, that's not a simplification. What the voice of reason is never defined by Waters. The voice of reason could be anything the listener wants it to be. It could be a voice calling for liberation, or a voice calling for fascism. Reason is never defined. Now, I don't think Waters means that second one, but there's nothing in the song that really says anything. I really don't like to use this word, but this is the textbook definition of pretentious. On the Run starts as one of the strongest tracks on the album, but deflates by its end. I like the song, but I think Waters could have said something more poignant and more expressive. Any Color You Like is ultimately better in terms of consistency, and I think it's nice sentimentally, but it is probably the weakest here with very little to say. I have to wonder if making the song longer would have been a better choice. You could focus on the instrumental, but also give more room for a more descriptive poem. It seems like the best moments on the album are when he's elaborating on the lyrics of a song. When it comes to instrumentals, however, where there isn't a defined meaning, he seems to have a bit of trouble grasping what it could be. Not conceptually, but theoretically. Speaking of instrumentals, I really like the band on this album. It's easy to compare to Redux's dull delivery to the original and all of its high-flying rock glory, but for what was intended, it feels like a perfect combination of people. There's regulars such as John Karen and Jonathan Wilson, but my favorite parts of the lineup this time around are the new additions. Bedouin or Asniv Kirkayan's vocals are gorgeous additions to the songs. Johnny Shepherd plays Hammond organ on the album and does these great soaring parts that Waters himself said he's never really experienced on his own album, and I have to agree. Via Mardot plays theremin across the album, often taking memorable solos like Time and The Great Gig in the Sky and making them into haunting melodies. It's one of the most unique decisions for the Redux, and I love it. While I feel like DSOTM Redux is essentially something Waters has done for years, the new lineup is actually exciting. I would love to hear him collaborate with these people again. I think they're great fits. The music itself, however, is also a sticking point. It is noticeably less exciting, and that's by design. It's so obvious to a point where it is genuinely daring. For all the words that could be spoken about how upsetting this new idea is, I think it works. Time is given this atmospheric intro with a pounding bass drum which eventually leads into these grand choruses and solos. Breathe is an acoustic track with some good orchestral and Hammond organ accents. Money is given a Tom Waits-esque rendition quoting Bari in E minor. The strongest point on the album is Us and Them, which is beautifully simple. It's definitely catching people off guard, but it gives the album a very unique and I think very strong feel. The Redux is ultimately a very unified release. Earlier I mentioned that I view DSOTM Redux not as the album we want, but the album we deserve, but I didn't really explain that, so I will here. While The Dark Side of the Moon holds up perfectly 50 years later, the world is not the same. We're still waging wars and backing militaries, praying for victory in situations where winning is an impossible feat. Hate and bigotry are being brought to the forefront with battles being fought over basic rights. The political right is arguing to subvert democracy itself. The world is the same in a way, but it feels much more bleak. It feels suffocatingly uncertain. This is the world that DSOTM Redux was made in. It's not a world where the possibilities feel endless, where there can be that authoritative voice to tell us what life is and isn't. The magic of the original album is turned into a downtrodden dirge. Waters isn't just a bassist and writer anymore, he's an old poet with visions of wars between good and evil, flags of different colors, and a world falling into darkness while the rich sit on rooftops. He's been banging the same drum since 1973, but after 50 years, your arms get tired. Your mind feels like it's on the verge of breaking. You could go mad at any moment. Nothing is innocent anymore. Nothing is fun. Everything is tiring and pushes you towards the edge. Don't you feel that way? This is what I think the Redux taps into. It presents the darkness of the 2020s on a silver platter. Dare I say, maybe in a roundabout way, that's why people are upset about it. There's no comfort to be found on the Redux. We can't abstract the politics and ignore the meaning. We're stuck with the prose. For those who want escapism, who want theatrics and guitar solos, there's no net to fall on. But importantly, I don't think Waters sees everything as merely doom and gloom. At the end of the album, where Jerry O'Driscoll once famously said there's no dark side of the moon, Waters states the opposite. Because the truth is, it's not all dark. There are still chances for us to recognize our fellow human beings across the world, no matter their race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, class, whatever. There's still time to go against the warmongers, Nazis, and tycoons. We can still fight for a better world. To adapt a lyric from Breathe, we shouldn't be afraid to care. But that's just my opinion. The Redux was never going to please everyone, and I don't think it's because the concept is bad. Waters went with an intensely different option, one I think is interesting, and he got nearly universal criticism for it. If he went closer to the record, however, the entire project would have been dismissed as a nostalgia act or as having nothing to say. These were the two options, and neither one could have gone well with the general public, who, I think, never had an appetite for a Waters record to begin with. Not to mention, at this point, anything Waters is going to do is going to be followed by negative press, both warranted and unwarranted. For as much as Waters said how he loved the original record and the contributions from his fellow bandmates, nothing could eclipse, no pun intended, the bad news of it all. The controversies and the headlines far outweigh the good things said, and that heavily shifts the bias against this album. Nothing really could be said to reverse course. DSOTM Redux was destined for infamy, but I think that Waters knew that. There might be some inclination to say he's oblivious to it all, but you can't ignore that he knows it. He's in on the joke. He calls attention to it on Brain Damage, where he laughs at the idea because, when you get down to it, even in effect, the idea is outlandish. The idea that he's gone mad with ego is literally in the promotional material for the Redux. The album, even as preposterous as it is self-aware. It's controversial by design, and I don't think I would have it any other way. As I sit here thinking about the album, I can only say how happy I am that it wasn't just another clone. There are thousands of performances and versions of this album out there, many of which try their hardest to replicate exactly what the original did. Pink Floyd, as a corporate entity, is basically doing that. For the 50th anniversary, they released an overpriced box set of material that's already out there. There's a remaster of the album, which really is not needed. There's a live album for Wembley, which is not only not complete, but already released in the 2010s. There were listening parties during eclipses, which got their own documentaries, but there isn't much to say there. They ran an animation contest, which garnered its own small controversy. The best thing to come out of the celebrations was a limited-run planetarium show. One has to ask, how much more there even is to that original recording. How much longer can this album be milked? It will always sell, but we're running out of things to hear and take in. That's what's cool about the Redux. It's the dark side of the moon, but turned on its head. There's a new experience here, something that nobody else is providing. It went in such a unique and polarizing direction, and maybe it's just me as a major fan who has heard this album for so long now, but that's worth something. We don't need another Dark Side of the Moon. We don't need another Money solo or another Claire Torrey. We already have that album. The DSOTM Redux isn't that, and that's a good thing.